distinguished members of the academic fraternity, distinguished members of the legal fraternity, and above all, students. Friends, I have three preliminary points to make. First is that it's always intimidating to speak before academia and academics. And with such a high-powered panel, both there and this side of academics, it is doubly intimidating. Academics tend to see everything in an orderly fashion. They see a holistic perspective. They have peaceful surroundings in which to analyze it. We lawyers live in chaotic splendor. Our perspectives are necessarily short-term. It's lucky if it's medium-term. But there is one saving grace, which has partly been mentioned by Raj. Both Justice Sikri and I are closet academics. I was an academic before I joined law, and but for a quirk of fate, I would never have joined law. Justice Sikri was an academic doing double duty, vigorous law and teaching. And we both practice vicarious pleasure in trying to pretend that we are continuing academics. My second preliminary point is that contrary to conventional wisdom, I am going to be very critical before what is partly a foreign audience. Normally one exercises restraint before what one might consider foreign audiences, but I do believe that on a subject like transforming the Indian judicial system or a subject like reform, words, as Palkhiwala put it, must be an assault on the senses. And unless words are an assault on the senses, reform will not follow. I am a little reassured by the fact that I am not speaking entirely to a foreigner. We have a very distinguished professor from Cornell, but she is a PIO after all. So I take that liberty, and also the liberty of the fact that Justice Sikri no longer has the shackles of office. He's a freer man now. My third and last preliminary point is that I think it deserves very, very great comprehensive accolades for the establishment of this Cornell India Center. I was astonished to learn from Professor Kalantri and from Raj that such a thing didn't exist. I have myself spent many years at England, Cambridge, and you always had in the field of economics a center like this, even qua India, for sociology, for even some ancient languages, and with India focuses, but astonishingly not for law. So I think this is a great beginning. It's filling up a very significant, conspicuous by its absence, gap. It brings back a personal flavor of pleasant memories. I have gone up to Niagara Falls and near Ithaca, but never to Cornell. But my father, and that was a remarkable reconnect because of Raj, spoke very fondly of his LLM at Harvard and even more fondly of his PhD at Cornell. And especially his development of a craze for apple pie a la mode. A la mode in America apparently means the ice cream which accompanies the apple pie. And I have heard many good things from him about Cornell, from where he did his PhD. And amazingly, at his last memorial lecture, within a few hours, Raj, with his usual amazing dynamism, produced a copy of his thesis on WhatsApp, the same day as a memorial lecture, no doubt facilitated by the fact that the Dean of Cornell Law School happens to be the husband of our special guest. So now we have full Indian reverse imperialism going to happen at Cornell. Well, friends, I've been asked to speak for about 30 minutes on something which the only hesitation I have speaking about it is that you will say this is something, almost everything I'm going to say is in a sense very banal, very obvious. So obvious that, as they said, the obvious has to be restated. I have always been amazed by the fact, in fact awestruck, by the enormous inefficiencies in the Indian judicial system, the tardiness of the Indian judicial system on which I've been asked to speak. And I think that's been matched only by the amazing simplicity of the reforms and the panaceas available to cure it. And it is quite astonishing as to how We have had innumerable ad nauseum lectures, seminars, talks, discussions on them. But somehow, it has not been woven into a composite comprehensive theme, applied consistently for long enough to produce results. But certainly, I start with a hesitation that nothing which I'm going to say is going to be novel. One must also start with the fact that the Indian legal system, by the legal system I include the judicial and all related limbs like tribunals, has, and I've spent a lifetime in it, so I can say with pride and certainty, it has certainly the best and the brightest at every level. Lawyers, judges, law persons, teachers. As far as substantive law is concerned, it has some of the most avant-garde doctrines. Imagine we are the only country to have invented the doctrine that a constitutional amendment can itself be unconstitutional. Something which the world over is now tried to be followed in imitation of the Indian invention. We are the proud creators of the PIL jurisdiction. Our judicial review doctrines would make Marbury and Madison, taught in the classes earlier, blush. There is no comparison. Despite that, the one thing which makes us hang our head in shame is the battle of the bulge, the battle of stockpile of arrears, of tardiness in the system, of inefficiencies in the system. And it truly reminds me of what Benjamin Franklin said, how for want of just a horseshoe nail, a battle could not be fought and a kingdom was lost. And I don't think that it's more than a horseshoe nail which is required to fix the Indian system, to fix the jagged edges of many such nails. So let me start with about 6 or 7 general points about the legal system, which need to be remembered as a backdrop before I come to the more nitty-gritty points. The first of these more general factors is, now it is rectified, I've been speaking on this subject for over 2 decades, and some of my suggestions have been followed, but it is still amazing how infrequently administration of justice is taught as a taught subject in law schools. Substantive law is taught, doctrines are taught, contract law is taught, basic structure is taught, but the administration of the legal justice system, how to make it more efficient, how to run it better, is, or till recently was, hardly a taught subject. I've been on the boards of many law schools, including Jodhpur and Delhi, 5-year courses, and we've tried to push some of these courses there. They have started in the last few years, but still, somehow, students' young minds are told how grand and great the doctrines are, but they cannot function without the vehicle in which they function being fixed. So I think certainly this is something which should start virtually as a mandatory core component of every law course, because that sensitizes our students early on as to how to run a system better. Not about law, but about running the law. Secondly, the scourge of backlog, I firmly believe, can be met only by less talk and more action, by fewer lectures like this one and more implementation, by less legislation and more ground achievement. It is actually the consistency of the application of solutions, the continuous application for a fixed time period, the focus of will determination that will show results and not merely theorizing or making grand plans or great schemes. Thirdly, you must always keep in mind that the mammoth number of cases pending, usually stagnant at around 3 crores, which is 300 lakhs, which is 30 million for our foreign audiences, should not really be seen as a deterrent or a depressant, because seen closely, they are largely meaningless numbers, and attacked at the base consistently over 5 to 7 years can collapse like a pack of cards. Fourthly, Thomas Hardy is important in all these approaches. Take care of the small things, the big things will take care of themselves. We tend to take care of the big and the very, very big things, and the small things sabotage the big ones. Fifthly, the approach to any such scheme has to be holistic, has to be not piecemeal. It has to be multi-pronged. It has to be curative as well as preventive. Sixthly, it has to be unconventional, even shocking. It has to jolt us out of our somnolence, because the present system chugs along in a major manner because of our somnolence. Chalta hai and sab theek hai gives it an inherent inertia, and I think that needs to be shocked out of by something akin to a high voltage electric shock. Seventhly, we should not underestimate the importance of attitudinal change. Attitudinal change is the least quantifiable. It's the most ambiguous. And yet, it is perhaps the most important. As they said, attitude, not aptitude, determines altitude. I'll give you an example. As a young lawyer in 1993, Justice Ahmadi, who had a very great focus on arrears, and the Supreme Court has remained since then, since 95-97, largely a less arrears court. It has increased but has remained within manageable limits. Started a program of which I was a part, an Indo-American collaboration with California, which was the inventor of ADR techniques. And Section 82 you have in the CPC is based on our report, which we authored, which was a menu of ADR options. But that is a separate topic. But in that program of 3 years, we found huge attitudinal change brought about in the mid-90s in the Supreme Court, which affected every stakeholder, lawyers, judges, staff, litigants, registry, so that adjournments, delays, filings, forms were not something which were routinely clogging the system. And it at that time brought down from a stagnant 1.5 lakh cases, that's 150,000 cases, to 33,000 for a long time. It has now again gone to somewhere around 60,000 and remains there, fortunately. So attitudinal change. And lastly, last but not the least, the importance of teamwork has to be emphasized. In this war on arrears, the entire judiciary, the entire legal system has to function as a seamless web, as an indivisible whole. The role of judges and the judiciary as a whole, but most particularly of the apex court. And the apex court has to be a catalyst, an organizer, a facilitator, a mentor, a monitor, an umpire, a participant, an observer. But all the other parts of the system have to work in a seamless teamwork system. Well, friends, as I said, let me come to the ordinary with extraordinary bad results. The ordinary is a simple truth. How can you expect hospitals to treat patients where you have wonderful hospitals, latest medical equipment, but no doctors? As on September 2019, and this figure keeps changing, you can have a January 2020 figure, it hardly matters. As of 3 or 4 months ago, the total judicial strength of all our 24 high courts put together in a country of 1.25 billion, mind you, a litigating public of at least 300 to 400 million, the total number of judicial posts at the High Court level were 1,079. Of those, 676 alone stood filled and 414 vacancies were there. Now the interesting thing is not September figure. The interesting thing is that for all times since independence, that's 70 plus years now, our High Courts have never functioned at more than 66 to 70% strength. So, well above or around one third, well above one fourth and around one third vacancies in a country which already has one of the lowest judge per population, judge per million population ratio. So, it's no point giving lectures and having seminars unless you can address this very simple issue. The funny part is, some 10 or 15, 12 years ago, we increased the strength of each high court. Strength means the total number of people who can sit on the high court from X to Y. And there was much fanfare about how arrears are going to be solved. Most of these figures I am giving you are high courts functioning below the earlier unincreased strength. Forget filling up the new strength. Most of them are functioning below the earlier unincreased strength. And you have, I have all the figures. I'm not going to take your time. The most shocking ones are Allahabad, 160 total posts, 43%, 70 posts vacant, 70. Uttar Pradesh is approximately population-wise the size of Europe, a little less. 70 judges. All the other examples, Bombay I have the figures, Delhi I have the figures. The smaller high courts suffer even more because Himachal used to have last year 8 out of 13 vacant, Chhattisgarh 14 out of 22 vacant, Jammu at last count I knew was 9 out of 17 vacant. The Chief Justice will know more of the latest figures. Calcutta, Delhi. The point is obvious, sad, and so remarkably simple to address. Now the same thing happens almost in the lower courts. The lower courts have a stagnant vacancy of about 25%. It sometimes reaches 27, 28, 30%, sometimes 23%. But average is about 25%. And we have the figures for the lower judiciary, that's everybody below the high court. The judge population ratio was for a long time 11 point something. That is one judge per million of Indian population. By a judgment over 20 years ago, that's 2002, the Supreme Court wielded a strong stick on pain of contempt to increase the judge population ratio. It has crawled over 20 years to 19 per 100 million, per million of population. A ideal figure is supposed to be somewhere around 50. I believe USA has 35 or 40 plus, France has better figures. But we are now, after 20 years of wielding the stick on plain of contempt by the Supreme Court, crawled up literally to 19. And that is, mind you, a misleading figure, because while the judge strength per million is 19, you have to factor in my one-third vacancies and one-fourth vacancies, which means the functioning ratio would probably be 12 or 13 per million of population. Well, the solution must be equally simple. As far as institutionally it is concerned, I had suggested in a lighter vein, something which is impossible, but just to shock the conscience many, many decades ago, that perhaps you should have a rule that unless you fill the post of a retiring incumbent 1 month before the incumbent retires, there should be a constitutional amendment saying that the incumbent will automatically continue. Because that's the only way we can solve this problem. Of course, in India, the result would be that you'd make sure that incumbents who are undesirable continue in this fashion by simply not appointing other people. But why can't there be a separate department in each court and ultimately monitored by a separate cell in the Supreme Court, laying down timelines which, in a flow chart, remind, harass ad nauseam till you reach that 1 month prior to retirement date, every stakeholder in the system. I am now talking of the formal system. I have not come to the informal system yet. Formally, we should have this monitoring cell, and we should have literally a stick wielded by the Supreme Court monitoring this absolutely relentlessly. The informal part, of course, has no solution except a feeling within us of sinful omission. Unless that feeling grows, I don't think this will change. The informal part is this. I used to joke for a long time that if you were to blindfold five people not from the law and send them to five different high courts in Delhi, in India, to say please choose in each high court the five best people eligible to be appointed to the bench. And remember, these five choosers or selectors are not lawyers. I can tell you that spending 2 weeks in a high court blindfolded, you can find out the best five people who deserve to be appointed. It's so simple. Of course, unfortunately, having found such suitable names, we then start a dangerous cocktail of local bar politics, judicial politics, and let me tell you, the politics of the judiciary will make the politics of Rajya Sabha and Lok Sabha blush. Personal rivalry, petty egos and the like, resulting either in inordinate delay, ensuring withdrawal of the candidate's name after ruining his practice, or sabotaging his fair name. So we are easy to appoint as far as finding is concerned, but then starts the process of disappointing, not appointing. It would help a lot if the apex court in some judgment or the other also introduced a uniform marking system. I've been sitting on selection boards for decades, and for ordinary things like students and others, we sit and say that let's mark on three broadly uniform fields. It doesn't matter what the fields are, but the three fields or the five fields should be uniform, because how I mark should not be how she marks in a different way and he marks in a different way. Whether that's integrity, whether it's judgments written, whether it's whatever, but at least let there be a uniform system of three to five fields to select. It's more important than the simple thing it sounds, because uniformity allows, there is of course going to be subjectivity in your marking, but it forces you to use your subjectivity within confined parameters. And it allows intergenerational, intertemporal comparisons. You apply it to chaprasis, to students, to employees, but you don't apply it for this absolutely ad hoc judge selection, even assuming it is done without the politics which surrounds it. And I think this status quoism needs to be changed. It needs to be changed by younger judges. An inflection point has to be reached. It has to come from within the system. I can't impose it, you can't impose it. But right-thinking people in the system can force a change. Simple things shock me. The NGAC case. As you know, we proposed a National Judicial Appointments Commission, which is known as the NGAC. Broadly, I was the mover of the bill. I spoke on the Constitutional Amendment Bill and in the Parliament. And I said that for nothing else, we've tried the executive primacy. And it was working well, but it started failing from the 80s, when the executive used to appoint. So I think a judicial collegium was the need of the hour, perhaps, with some of the depths we had attained in the 80s. It came along in the 90s. You tried it and you found it full of holes by the new century and in the last 10 years. Well, it's time to try another one at least. You've tried both and let's see the other one. Anyway, the bill was passed. Now, what I'm saying is something different. It's shocking that the Supreme Court spent about a year in hearing that matter and ultimately striking down the NGAC, Constitutional Amendment Bill, and the statute. But for some inexplicable, strange reason, even the strongest proponents of the NGAC, like me and others, never asked the Supreme Court to stop appointment judges in those 1 year. For the whole 1 year, do you know, collegiums adopted a self-denying, astonishing, mysterious reason to stand still. There was no stay by the court. In fact, the funny part is that one of us asked the court that you should clarify. So the court said, why should we clarify? We have given no stay. But the same collegium, many of which were hearing, who would be disqualified from the matter, the collegium of the same court chose not to appoint judges for almost 1 year in this country. Do you know the staggering areas it reached at that time? This is criminal neglect. As I said, pardon me, words are going to be a bit of an assault on the system. We have planned expenditure on the judiciary is very small. We should increase that. Now, of course, the plans have gone, the planning commission has gone, but as long as they were there, the percentage was very small. It's below 1%, then it crawled up to 1%, then a little bit above 1%. But the perennial lament about an underfunded judiciary is also a myth, because the judiciary, apart from the planned expenditure in the budget, whose percentage should increase, gets a lot of special grants. The Finance Commission published this astonishing set of figures. It said from 2010 to 2015, approximately 50, 60 and 70% of the funds allocated were not utilized. They were allocated for morning, evening courts, ADR centers, Lok Adalats, legal training of judges, training of lawyers, etc., etc. 50% at the least, and in some years 60 and 70% were in fact had to, as they say, lapse or return because they could not be utilized. So sometimes the lament of underfunding is exaggerated. it is inefficiency somewhere, a lack of will somewhere else. A sixth point, which I have been writing about for the last 10 years. Again, I said it's so simple, I'm astonished. It's a one line, one sentence or three sentence point. It's obvious, but sometimes the obvious has to be restated. Do you know that Article 224A in this country has never been used for the High Court as far as I know? There may be one or two stray cases which I missed out. As far as I know, for the High Courts, no. 224A, for those who don't know it, is a very simple provision which says that a Chief Justice of X High Court can, with the concurrence of the central government, appoint ad hoc judges from former judges of that High Court or from another High Court. Now, the Supreme Court has used it about four times. Justice Reddy of the Supreme Court, K.J. Reddy, N.D. Oja, I remember, one or two more. The point here is that with unfilled vacancies, you have a ready talent of proven judges who may have retired, but who are prepared to come and deal with forgotten criminal appeals of 20 years old, sitting quietly in two courtrooms and disposing of a large thing, which happened in the Supreme Court for a while, with the four appointments at different times of ad hoc judges. Supreme Court has a similar provision. But in the High Court, nobody has done it. In the Supreme Court also, it was discontinued for a reason which most Supreme Court judges will not tell you. Perhaps Justice Sikri knows this or not, I don't know. There was a dispute about seniority. So when a judge retires, he comes back as an ad hoc judge. Technically, he's senior to the sitting judge. So how must you work that out in terms of which courtroom to sit, how to sit, etc.? There was some small fracas and that got discontinued. The point I'm making again is Benjamin Franklin, for want of a nail, a kingdom was lost. This is a ready-made pool of known judicial tried and tested talent. And while you do your politics and appoint or disappoint someone, at least have an ad hoc judge doing work continuously. Give him forgotten 1960s and 70s and 80s appeals. He'll be happy to dispose. There are plenty of people here who would want to give that service for 2 years, 1 year, 6 months. We don't do it. Of course, it can be expanded further. I'm glad Justice Chandrachud has commented recently on something, again, I'd written long ago, recorders in UK. When I was a student in Cambridge, QCs, senior advocates, would commonly take up 1 year to 2 years as judges. They were called recorders. And they would simply dispose of a huge number of lesser cases which clog up your system. If you had a proper scheme, I'm sure some people here would be prepared to do it. But you have never experimented with it. You have never tried it. Also, we have not done track studies, statistical studies, which must be localized district-wise. Now, it is on an average found that perhaps the, and I'm not sure of the figure now, but I have the idea earlier, and Professor Kalantri has done some interesting statistical studies for other aspects of the Supreme Court. This study should be ongoing every year and it should be supplied to all the districts in India. Two or three general points about these studies. One, it appears that courts lower than the High Court normally have many more criminal cases than civil cases. Number two, it appears that most High Courts have many more civil cases than criminal cases. Number three, it appears that individual districts can have any combination. Some districts have three times as much criminal cases as civil cases and vice versa. Now, the track of allocation of judges is not matched with this. The track of allocation within the High Court, of course, is all changing now. It's happening in a better way. It should be constantly calibrated to meet this difference in the nature of the case. And in particular, and most importantly, there must be a fixed track for old cases and a fixed track for new. There is no way in which at least High Court should be allowed to compromise on this, and indeed the Supreme Court as well. Because somehow or the other, the separate track for new cases will have to manage the new inflows, but the old ones have to attack at the base and they have to be forced to do it. Judges have to be forced to do it for 6 months, although the actual judges dealing with it can change. I don't think this track system is working in an institutionalized system. It is, of course, working. An individual Chief Justice in an individual High Court does it. An individual Chief Judge in a district system does it. But in a methodical system with statistical studies supplied every time it is not being done. Small things like absence of uniformity and standardization. Computerization, when I talked to the erstwhile people running the national judicial grid, they said, did you know that a writ petition is described in 8 different ways or 12 different ways in different high courts in the country? Somebody calls it CRWLJ, somebody calls it MA, somebody calls it something else. Then what constitutes a writ petition also may be different. 226, 227. Now the point here I'm making is that it prevents standardization, uniformization. In the names of legacy, the Bihar man says, my high court has a legacy of calling it this. And somebody else somewhere says that the legacy in this high court was to call it like this or to classify it like this. You cannot subject these cases to statistical analysis unless you have absolute uniformity in a quasi-federal system like India. And that has to be done by the Supreme Court. It has to be done by a fair amount of coercion if it doesn't happen voluntarily, and it doesn't seem to be happening voluntarily. There is a booklet published by the Law Ministry in a formal sense and released by some party in the Law Ministry precincts almost every few years, a compilation of good practices. The good practices released and thrown into the dustbin. Nobody follows it. They have tried an eclectic mix of collection of good practices from 10 or 15 high courts. And some of them are good, but there is no discipline. The Supreme Court, ultimately judges are very difficult to control and deal with. Supreme Court has to deal with somewhere, and Supreme Court actually has no administrative power over high court judges. So it has to be by a process of interaction, participation, education. It has to come from within. But a lot of those salutary good practices in that booklet, if followed in a uniform manner, would be extremely useful. Friends, I am finishing shortly, keeping in view the delays in the system. There will be no delays in the speech making. But I want to end by saying that ultimately all this has to focus on the ABCD of judicial reform, where my ABCD, A stands for access, B for backlog, C for cost, and D for delay. This has to be the four pillars of every step you take. Every step you take, if you decide a case, I have a chart here. At a seminar I spoke, my friend Siddharth Luthra produced that chart and we discussed it. The same issue in the Supreme Court alone, the number of times it is referred, case X gets referred to from 2 to 3, 3 to 5, sometimes gets back referred, and that has engendered, by the time it ends, progeny across India of thousands of cases. So the process of reference, re-reference, the time taken, and in the meanwhile, bewildered high courts following one line or the other line, there is no finality. If the court was to micromanage, Supreme Court that is, and look at those references, that chart is very, very instructive because it shows how one case traveled almost for 5 years in references. In the meanwhile, I am sure generating offspring and progeny at the high court level of thousands, if not lakhs of cases. These are things which clog the system. Nani Palkiwala is the right person to quote when you need words to assault the senses. He said, may I turn now to the situation in India, which has the second largest number of lawyers in the world. While it is true that justice should be blind, in our country it is also lame. It barely manages to hobble along. The law may or may not be an ass, but in India it is a snail. It moves at a pace which would be regarded as unduly slow in a community of snails. A lawsuit once started in India is the nearest thing to eternal life ever seen on this earth. Some have said that litigation in India is a form of fairly harmless entertainment. But if so, it seems to be a very expensive way of keeping the citizenry amused. If litigation were to be included in the next Olympics, India would be quite certain of winning at least one gold medal. And friends, now really, really concluding, I must end on one point which I forgot to mention earlier. All the points you have noted, appointment of judges in time, having infrastructure, lower judiciary, etc. But a new trend has started, a very disturbing trend in the last 3 to 4 years. And that trend is, and we all, each one of us, Justice Sikri cannot speak so frankly as I can, but each one of us has our horror stories. The new trend is that you, in a collegium, nowadays with interviews, I'm told, but earlier without interviews, select a person. And the collegium actually rejects a large number of people, then he selects one or two. And they then recommend to the government. And the government routinely returns it back that itself is wrong, but it is understandable because 2 9-judge benches and 7-judge benches have given them the power of one return. Just like the president has the power of one return of a bill. Now, what is disturbing is that for the last 3 years, two interesting things happen. The second time it is sent back, they can't return it because the law is very clear. So they simply neither accept nor return it. There is simply neither yes nor no. There are cases documented, including one person from my chamber who's being sworn in next week, who has waited for 1 year with neither a yes or a no. Now, we give seminars and lectures, we express hope. Justice Call is expressing anguish every day I find in a bench nowadays, saying that there are batches where 10 people have applied, now in an interview 9 are rejected, only 1 is recommended. That one chap is not appointed for 1 year after a second reference. So what is the solution? The solution is simple, and something I wrote more than 2 years or 3 years ago, and I mean no disrespect. It has to be done only once, and this will stop. A notice of contempt has to be issued. I had written, jokingly, law minister, but to the law secretary at least, that in our judgment, we have said, after a second reference, you cannot refer back, you cannot override, our second reference is final. I can guarantee that with 2 notices of contempt in 2 different cases, this practice will stop. And it doesn't matter which government, I'm not talking politics. All governments may have done some sort of this. It has, of course, increased in frequency in the last few years. But why do judges give us homilies from the bench? Why do judges give lectures, or I give lectures at seminars? But why doesn't the bench give a notice of contempt to a law secretary who, on a second reference, has said neither yes nor no? I'm giving you a case of a person next week after 9 months. And he, by the way, was the only selectee out of a panel of 8. So this is an institutional response. It's not to do with A or B. It's not to do with favorites. It's time the Supreme Court implemented its own orders. There are 3 judgments which say, and all 9 judges, that if we refer a second time, you jolly well appoint that person. I think these are, as I said, so obvious as to be somewhat banal. I do not claim any claim to originality, but I do say with a tinge of great regret and sadness that while we heavily criticize what we see on the roads sometimes, in Hyderabad we saw, in Uttar Pradesh we saw, instant justice. This is alternative dispute resolution, ADR, of the streets. And this is horrible, it's horrendous. And you cannot justify it, but you can understand it. You see a movie like Ab Tak Chappan, instant justice on the roads. You cannot justify it, you must criticize it, but you can at least understand where the pain and agony is coming. And therefore, before anything else, we have to set this part of our house in order. Otherwise, may I end with that phrase of that famous shayar. He said, Dopahar tak bik gaya bazaar ka har ek jhoot. Dopahar tak bik gaya bazaar ka har ek jhoot. Aur main ek sach ko lekar sham tak baitha raha. Thank you.